interesting little story before we start. My office is, as you know, over there, and every year I watch the Time Warner broadcast of our coach because he goes before me. So I'm in my office, and right below my TV, we have my whiteboard, which, you know, you put the roster on with a marker. You know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and, you know, depending upon the year, it's either Derek Fisher at the 1 or Shaquille at the 5, and every year it changes. And, of course, you know, Kobe Bryant's up there as well. So looking at the broadcast and seeing the whiteboard right below it, I decided, well, this is as good a time as any to get an eraser. And so I got the eraser and went to Kobe's name and went from left to right and pushed the eraser. And when I lifted the eraser, the name was still there. I guess at some point the marker just stays. So I had to get the spray and, you know, get the wipe and take it off. It took a while, but the name stayed.
So he's coming back this year.
The name is off the board. The spray with the whatever it is, it worked, but it wasn't easy. Before I open it up to questions, I would be remiss, you know, from a personal point of view, and of course, you know, I think the organization did a great job of saying goodbye. But a 20-year chapter, you know, has come to a close, and 1996 to 2006. I've said many times, you know, my son was born on the night of his first game in 1996, and he's now almost 20 years old, you know, in college. And, Kobe finally, after 20 years, you know, decides to retire. So from a personal point of view, thank you for such a wonderful career. What you've done for the organization and what you've done for the city. It is hard to close the book on this chapter, but it has come to that point where we have to do it. And I can't begin to imagine a better ending or send-off than what he gave us on Wednesday night. I've gone to Knicks games when they played the Lakers in the finals in 1972. And I've been involved in every finals here in Los Angeles. You know, except for the 80 championship finals. Of course, people talk about Game 7 6 years ago, how it felt in that building. I didn't know what expectations held for me for that Wednesday night, but I would put that night up against any Game 7, any championship, in terms of a performance and the last game of the season. Certainly didn't wipe away a record, but that was a special, special evening. And if you were there, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Certainly if you watched it on TV, you had a feel, but it's something that I don't think we'll ever see again. If you put it all together, one player, 20 years, we saw his talent from the moment the game started. But we also saw snippets of, you know, what Kobe really is, which is a player that played injured, a player that would miss 5 or 6 of his first shots, but continue, you know, as if he didn't. You know, we've seen that so many times. It's that focus, it's that fight, it's that belief in himself, his determination. So really, the game ended up being a game about 60 points and willing a team that didn't win many games to win a game. Clearly, we don't win that game without his will. And how many times have we seen that? And the fact that, 43 minutes in an NBA game, we've seen so many times a guy that probably shouldn't be on the court. And I don't know how he got through that game. The fatigue level, and then putting the team on his shoulders one last time. It was just a spectacular evening, and I know most of you were there, and you know exactly how I feel. So having said that, the chapter closes. The name is off the board, and at this point I'd like to open it up to questions.
Yeah,
Mitch, as you turn the page, you know, to the next page and the next chapter in Laker basketball, will this offseason be one of your most difficult because Kobe is leaving or has left? And when will you even start to think about the future of your coaching staff?
Well, this offseason, in some ways, will be more difficult. In some ways, it'll be easier. You know, the chapter on Kobe has closed. As you know, the books with the cap, the money, you know, that no longer goes to Kobe will free up a lot of cap space for us. We do feel this year we have a lot more assets on our team than we did last year. You know, the last 2 years, although we had Kobe, tough to predict how much he'd play with his injuries. And, you know, a year ago, you know, we had a good player in the draft in Julius Randle, but got hurt in game one. So it was difficult for us to get out there and sell ourselves to free agents. But you always try to do that, no matter what. But I think this offseason, we do have more assets in terms of players. We still don't know the status of our pick. We'll know that on May 17th. And then, of course, you know, we had cap room last summer, but we'll have almost triple of what we had last summer. That doesn't mean we'll use it all. You know, we have to recruit effectively, and we have to hope and we get the opportunity to use our money wisely. You know, we may use it all. We may only use what we feel is prudent. But we feel we're in a much better situation than we were a year ago or 2 years ago. The second part of your question was about the coaching staff.
Yes.
Go ahead.
No, have you thought of when will you start thinking about retaining or what any moves that you'll make?
Well, Byron and the staff are under contract. And I know I said that a couple of months ago, and it wasn't a whole lot to run with. At this point, which has been our tradition with Dr. Buss, and we've continued it with Jimmy, would be, you know, take a couple of days where that could be 3 or 4 days or a week, you know, let things settle down a little bit and meet. And Jimmy and I will meet, and perhaps Jimmy and I and Byron will meet, and we'll review the season in terms of, you know, the players. There's a lot to discuss. That will come about. I don't have a date. I don't know if it'll be a week or two, but we do it every year, and this year will be no different.
Did you personally like the job that Byron did this year?
I think Byron has done an excellent job under the circumstances that he's had to deal with the last 2 years. This year in particular was a difficult year for a coach to wade his way through. Clearly not knowing, you know, Kobe's status, you know, game to game, knowing that he wanted to play, but sometimes he just couldn't play. And I think Byron mentioned our goal was to get him through the season, especially once he announced it would be his last season. And I myself, up to a week ago, was a mess watching him play on the road trip, thinking that maybe, you know, something might happen and he might not get to the last game. Now, I didn't know what would happen in that last game, okay? Then I really would have been worried. But that was a concern. We've got a lot of young players. Julius was essentially a rookie. So Jordan Clarkson, another starter, was a second-year player who didn't play much at all in his first year until the end of January or February. And then, of course, we added you know, D'Angelo and Larry Nance and Anthony Brown, who ended up being on the injured list at the end of the year. So, you know, if you look at all the circumstances that Byron had to coach under, you know, I think he did a great job.
Mitch, how did Kobe's presence throughout the year impact how you can evaluate those young players, either positive or negative?
Well, the good thing when he did miss games is that it freed up minutes, you know, for other players to play that might not have played. You know, for example, Anthony Brown didn't play much at all when Kobe was in the lineup. But when Kobe was not in the lineup, it gave, even at some times, Anthony a chance to start. So that helped. You know, going forward, it's tough, you know, to know that, you know, if Kobe was in his 10th year, then it's a little bit easier to evaluate you know, your team, because you know Kobe's going to be there for 5 or 6 more years. So you look at the young guys or the guys that are on the team and you say, well, how can they play with him going forward? Okay, but, you know, we knew he wouldn't be there beyond this year. So it does make it a little bit more difficult in some ways.
Mitch, where do you stand on just the overall issue this season? You know, how much opportunity should D'Angelo and Julius be given starting from off the bench finishing games?
Well, it was uncharted waters for us. We did go through it actually 20 years ago with one player, which was Kobe Bryant. When we drafted Kobe, he was 17 years old, and he turned 18 in the fall of his first year. And without having the information in front of me, I don't think he started his first 2 years. In fact, his first year hardly played at all. So we have a little bit of experience, you know, with young players, but we've never had this many, you know, young players on the team at the same time. And there's a price to pay for that. You know, and you know, as you know, we went through some tough times with young players this year. But the other part of it is the only way to move on, you know, after a player has played 20 years, is to hope that you can get some young players to build around. Unless you draft a young player, you cannot get a young player. You can get free agents, but typically those are players that have been drafted in the first round, have gone through 4 years of a contract, and then have probably signed an extension for another 4 years. So those players are going to be in their mid to late 20s if they're available. So if you want a young player, you have to get that player through the draft.
You guys have taken some aggressive swings at bigger ticket free agents over the last couple of seasons. How have those experiences, Steve, how do you think those will inform your approach this summer?
Every summer is different. And we have positioned ourselves in the last 2 years to have money every year. As much as we'd like to build through the draft with young players, that could take 10 to 15 years. And we don't feel we have that kind of timeline here in Los Angeles. So our approach has been to build through the draft, be aggressive in free agency, and if you have the assets, then you have the ability to make trades. Cap room in itself, you know, gives you the opportunity to bring players on board. You know, for example, Roy Hibbert last year was brought on board because we had cap room, and he had a one-year deal, and it gave us a chance to look at him and maintain flexibility going forward.
Does the amount of space that you have this year make it, I guess, I think it'll make it easier, you know, to maybe go after the bigger guys if you want them, but also not lose out on some of the next tier players that help fill out a roster and develop the rest of it? You've been in either or situations before.
Right.
Is it different this summer?
It is different. You know, having, you know, as much cap room as we have, which would approach, you know, $60 million, depending on how you look at it, it would give us the ability to bring on board multiple max players if they wanted to come here. We can bring on one max player and use the other money for 2 or 3 other players and pay them very well. Or you can divvy it up, you know, any way you want. Last year, we had the ability to bring on one max player. So we're in a better position this year. The downside is, because the cap is going up dramatically, a lot of teams are going to have the ability to bring on a max player. You know, in fact, most teams, with the exception of 2 or 3, will have that ability. I don't know how many, you know, other than us, I think there'll be 1 or 2 others that will approach the amount of flexibility we have.
Mitch, how does free agency change with Kobe not here? What do you think that does for the perception of this place as a destination for potential free agents, and how does that change your guys' pitch to free agents?
Well, I think anybody that watched the game on Wednesday night knows, you know, what it's like to play in Los Angeles and to be successful here. I think that to some degree could help us, because we are selling, you know, the city, the franchise, you know, our fan base. You know, to potential free agents. That's what we sell. I think once again, you know, we're in an excellent position to recruit players here in Los Angeles. I do.
What do you tell them in terms of the on-court? Aside from the city, the legacy, all that stuff, what do you tell them about the on-court product? If they're saying, okay, what can you...
Well, I think a lot of free agents, you know, with Kobe going year to year, you know, weren't sure if he would be there or if he wouldn't be there. And now they know he's not there. And that could be a positive or a negative, depending upon how a free agent looks at it. But he's not going to be there this year. So I think if you're a free agent, you look at the assets that the Lakers have, and you make a decision, you know, can I go there and be the guy they build around, be a part of what they build around? You know, I think going forward, we're going to continue to have, you know, financial flexibility. So it's tough to predict, you know, what free agents will do. The rules, you know, are such now that, you know, every team that recruits free agents to some degree, especially if they're max players, will be at a disadvantage because we could only offer a four-year deal versus a five-year deal. So that makes it tough. But every year there are players that, you know, do move on. And we're hoping that we're in a position this offseason, you know, to use our money wisely.
Mitch, you have young players, essentially. Kobe's gone, and yes, you have a few veterans. But the core of what you'd be potentially selling to a top free agent is the opportunity to play with guys like D'Angelo and Jordan and Julius, young guys. Do you think that's a concern or a draw, or maybe it's a detriment in that a veteran who might want to leave and come here might want to win a lot mm-hmm. sooner?
Well, a year ago, we had enough money for one max player. And at that point, if you were a max player a year ago, you're looking at our team and you're saying, they got the number two pick. They got Julius Randle, who played one game. And they got Kobe, who rarely played, and he's going into his last year probably. That's not an attractive situation. Okay, but this summer, you know, we could get, you know, at least two max players, or you can get a max player and two or three other veterans. So you could get players, multiple players, whether they talk amongst themselves or whether we, you know, figure out who wants to play with who beginning on July 1st. So we're in a position not only to add one player, which is the position we were in a year ago, you know, we're in a position to add multiple veteran players, you know, to the existing core we have.
Could a path emerge where to bolster that veteran core that some of the youth could be shipped and trade out to bring in more veterans? Is that something that you could at least entertain?
Absolutely. I mean, anything's possible. You know, there's three ways to improve the team. Yeah. Cap room, free agency, trades. And we like our core of young players. You know, we have, you know, several free agents, some of which will be restricted. You know, that we have to make, you know, prudent decisions on, and they'll, you know, most of which I think have already been made, but that still needs to be discussed. So there's a lot that needs to be done in the next two or three months.
If you do get a top three pick, obviously if it goes to Philadelphia, if it's not in the top three, do you have, if you're going with veterans and then you've all got all these young players, when is it too many young players to develop? You've already got the young core that you have. Do you bring in another number one pick and then a second rounder?
Well, our preference right now, you know, it'd be great to get the pick. Okay, if we don't get the pick, then we get the pick next year. So it's not like we lose the pick. We just don't get it this year, we get it next year. Of course, the downside is, you know, we don't want to be as bad as we were this year, next year. How many players can you put together?
How many young players can you
I could easily envision, you know, using the pick, adding that player to this team. But we would be aggressive in pursuing veteran free agents during the offseason. I thought that our veterans this year, you know, by design, in particular Meta, you know, did a wonderful job, you know, kind of equaling and balancing out the locker room. You know, believe it or not, he was a stable and rock solid influence in the locker room. And we had a couple of guys like that, Brandon Bass, Lou Williams. Didn't solve all of our young people problems, but it got us through you know, a lot of tough periods that if you didn't have veterans in the locker room can get really tough.
One of the things that at least is talked about in terms of the challenges that you guys face, it actually revolves around, I mean, certainly in the front office and the timeline that Jim laid out, the notion that if the team doesn't make, I think you said the conference finals next year or something like that, the changes can be made with basketball operations. How does that uncertainty impact what you guys do this summer or the way the franchise is perceived by people outside?
Yeah, I mean, that's a question for somebody else, not for me. This is not a process you can rush. And, you know, if in fact that is true, you know, that doesn't mean, you know, I'm going to encourage us to go out and spend $60 million on veteran players to long-term deals that might only assure us mediocrity. That's not how, you know, we've sat down and decided to advance this team. Every year, you know, I think we've improved our assets. And this year, you know, we don't know about our pick, but we knew it. We do know about the cap and the flexibility. And we're going to continue to try to make prudent basketball decisions based on the three ways we can, which is with drafting young players, making a good trade if we can, and then using our money wisely.
And even with the record, how do you characterize how they've done the court development in terms of meeting or not meeting any expectations?
I thought it was tough to really evaluate, you know, progress through the season. You know, there's always a situation where there's, you know, two steps forward, one step back, you know, three steps forward, you know, two steps back, or, you know, vice versa. You know, where a guy has a couple of bad games and then he has a good week. You know, I didn't think it was anything that was a consistent pattern. You know, I thought we got to a point where we played really good basketball with our young players, and then maybe we took a step back. Overall, you know, in this league, the toughest thing for young players that are drafted high or drafted in the first round is getting playing time. Coaches really only have their record to fall back on, and naturally they would want to play veterans. And to Byron's credit, you know, he gets the picture here, which is to develop young players. Certainly, you know, Kobe at times missing games opened up minutes, and that gave some of our young players a chance to play. But that's really the most important thing in developing young players, is getting them minutes, and that's how they grow. Of course, we've got to have coaches that work on the players individually, side baskets, you know, film room, video room, you know, our analytic department, sitting down with players and showing them charts and graphs. All that's important, but the biggest thing is getting these guys on the court. And a lot of rookies over the years have had a hard time getting on the court, and what that does is it slows their development and really puts the team in a tough spot. Because you have to make decisions on players that are drafted in the first round now in 2 years. You got to decide the third year option after the second year. And, to me, the minutes this year were the most important sign of progress.
D'Angelo had a run, started at the end of February, 8 games. I think he averaged 23 points and 5 assists. Is that what he can do in this league, or is that just an 8-game fluke? What's your thoughts on
that? No, I don't think it's a fluke. I think D'Angelo, and that's part of our challenge going forward, is to find out how we're going to best use his talents. He can do two things. He can do a lot of things, but the two things that I know he can do is he can score, and he's got a gift to pass the ball, a unique gift. And not just a willing passer on an entry pass, but I'm talking about a guy that can see the court that nobody else can see the court. And he can look one way and see a guy and drop a pass the other way. Do you want to convert D'Angelo into a passer and not utilize his ability to score the ball? Or do you want to encourage him to score the ball and not utilize his passing ability? I think that's something that we have to, as an organization and as a coaching staff, decide how to use his talents the best way. Jordan, I think, is more of an attack player offensively. Yeah, as Brian mentioned, he needs a lot of work defensively, as does D'Angelo. But I don't think Jordan at this time has D'Angelo's gifts. But I don't think you can characterize either player as a point guard. And the way the game is going now in the NBA, I'm not sure the best teams can characterize their players by position.
Do
I mean, you have guys that are 6'7" now that play the five spot in the NBA. We saw that last year with Golden State.
Mitch, regarding the situation with D'Angelo and Nick, do you have any concern about the implications of that when it comes to free agency?
No.
Why not?
The issue, I know, was brought back to light today. But every day that goes by, it becomes less and less of a story. Both players, you know, did the right thing, you know, in terms of addressing and, when necessary, you know, making amends or making an apology, acknowledging a mistake. And we've dealt with players in this on this organization, in this team, that have made mistakes over the years. And we've gotten through it and had great teams and won championships. Anybody in this room right now that has never made a mistake in their life, you can stand up and take a step forward. You know, especially when we were 18 or 19 years old. I don't see anybody standing up and taking a step forward. And I'm looking at a pretty successful group. So that's what's going to happen with D'Angelo.
Nobody's ever said that in the room full of media people before.
I think it's the first time I've ever said it, too.
It's very flattering.
Can Nick be back next year? Can they play together for a full season again?
I think they can. I think a bigger issue is, you know, Nick didn't fit this year. And once again, I'm getting ahead of myself a little bit. And Nick and I talked about it with Byron yesterday. You know, Nick is gifted in being able to score the ball, but he didn't fit. There weren't the minutes, you know, that he wanted or that the coach decided to allocate this year. So I think that's a bigger question going forward. You know, can we figure out a way to use his ability to score the ball and get him to do the other things? And if not, you know, then we decide what to do at that point. But I don't think if they were in the locker room together next year, that would be a big problem. You know, it might not be the best thing at first, but Nick is too good a person, you know, to not get through issues. I've known him now for years, and as tough as it is, I know he'd get through it.
But there's a stretch provision, and if there was a player that you had under contract multiple years that you looked to trade and didn't find a trade, could you look to possibly stretch to increase your cap room?
Well, whenever you stretch a player, all it does is help you with cap room. You know, and a lot of teams do that, and then we did it once. Well, we did the amnesty, but there's two reasons why you do it. If you're in a tax, you might want to do it. And also to create cap room. So we've got, depending upon how you look at it, close to $60 million. It could be $55 million. We have a couple players with options. So if you did look to stretch a player, then you'd have to say, well, I need another $2 or $3 million. So now you go from maybe 56 to 58. So it depends what you would do with that extra $2 million to get from 56 to 58. It may not make sense to do it. So those are the decisions that you'd have to make.
Rich, what do you expect the tone and tenor to be when you do sit down with Byron Scott and with Jim? Certainty that he's the guy moving forward, or clarity that he's...
Byron and I have spent all day together yesterday, and we visited today for about 45 minutes. And I anticipate an informal lunch at some point in the next week or two with myself and Byron and Jim.
Mitch, you said you thought he did a great job. In the circumstances, does it remain a possibility that you could make a coaching change? as the man who leaves every door open, I realize.
Right. I don't want to go back to what I said 3 months ago. You know, he's under contract, and if anything changes, you know, we'll be the first to let you know. Okay. So everybody gets reviewed. I'm sure over the last 16 years behind closed doors, people were talking about me and reviewing me as well. Anything is possible. Right now, all I anticipate is some informal meetings and, you know, moving on from there.
Mitch, when you look at the roster, and especially with Kobe leaving, it seems to be thin on the wing. You talked about the versatility around the league, and you have all the different ways to add players, but do you have a priority in when you're looking at the draft and free agency to add to certain elements, or are you still just...
Yeah, I think our backcourt is better off, you know, than our front court. Depending upon, you know, the lottery and where we end up with our pick, I think we do have to address, you know, the front court. And if you can put a wing player in the front court, that would be, you know, a good thing to do as well. We don't have enough data on Anthony Brown right now. We look at him as a wing player going forward. But he, at this point, you know, is not going to help us win a lot of games. I think he's a development player right now that needs to work and get better. And I think he will. But if you're looking at players to help us win games next year, I think we need a lot of help in the front court.
Then you mentioned the final game and what impact that could have had for anybody watching. Clarkson said yesterday that something just kind of hit him about being a Laker. Did you feel like you needed something like that to not necessarily restore luster, but to sort of remind people of what it can be in that situation?
You know, the whole evening was really... You know, a surreal evening. You know, something that started out with 5 missed shots, you know, just turned into a dramatic, unpredictable performance, and a game that was meaningless. Utah wanted to win that game, and they didn't want Kobe to score. In fact, there were times when they looked to double-team Kobe so he wouldn't score. And when Kobe had his 81, that wasn't the case. So that game had an awful lot of storylines to it. And the fact that the players, you know, rather than showing immaturity, which we saw a lot during the season, you know, with making sure that the ball didn't move as much as it should. They gave it all up. And, you know, their only goal was to make sure that the guy that was on the court, you know, went out the best way he possibly could. And not only did he go out that way, you know, he put on a performance for the ages. And on top of that, you know, willed us to win the game. So in the locker room after the game, you know, Byron spoke, Kobe spoke, you know, Gary spoke also. There's no doubt that there was a different vibe in that locker room after that game. And based on 14 exit interviews yesterday, I think every player, you know, had a different sense of what it's like to play for this organization in that building in front of those fans.
Says Larry Nance.
Everybody loves Larry. Everybody does. His physical ability is off the charts. You know, he's a little bit undersized. You know, when I have the exit meetings, I talk to players, and we end up talking about pluses and minuses of players. And really, the only minus that anybody said about Larry was, you know, he's too unselfish. We do need him to be more aggressive offensively. He can make shots. You know, I do think he can go into the corner and make threes. He's got to put the ball down on the floor. You know, he did make it through an 82-game season, although two-thirds of the way through, you know, we held him back on back-to-backs. You know, he had an ACL a year and a half ago, 2 years ago. That's not fully rehabbed. So that's one thing he has to work on during the offseason. But he is a little undersized. He makes up for it in desire and athletic ability. But he needs to work on his game as well.
Between Larry, to some degree, Julius Mike, do you see enough in those guys, in their ability to move around on the floor? You know, Larry sort of a 3-4, can Julius go kind of move around in other places like that you feel like you have enough flexibility to go out and get the best players that you can, or is Julius sort of locked in as a more traditional power forward?
Well, I don't think Julius is a traditional power forward. You know, he's got to work on his game too. You know, he's got to get to the point where, you know, he's dependably finishing. You know, he's got to work on his ability to, you know, draw defenders, you know, when he's on the perimeter. I'm not sure he has a position. I'm not sure Larry Nance has a position. And the kid up in Golden State, Draymond Green, I don't know what his position is. So I think today you're just trying to get basketball players that can interchange. And if you decide to play that style of game, which is the style of game that's being played in the NBA right now, I'm not sure you're going to be able to define players by position like we once did.
A quote-unquote power forward that has a skill set that works complementary with Julius could very well easily fit with what you guys need to do. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, power forwards used to be, 6'10", 6'11". And now, I'm not even sure you want to call it a power forward. I think we just put a number on it. Say he's a four. It's the game has changed. The way the game is coached has changed. In 1978 or 79, I was in Washington. They introduced the three-point shot. I think you saw one or two a game for like 3 or 4 years. Now it's not unlikely, it's not unheard of to see 60 to 70 in a game. The rules with hand checking have allowed, the game to be more free-flowing. So, we have to monitor, how the game is played today, decide if we're on board, and then how long is the game going to be played that way? Is this the way it's going to be for the next 20, 30 years? Will there be a three-point line, that'll be moved out? Will there be a four-point line? Bill Burtka has always been advocating a four-point play. So, we don't know how it's going to go, but I think the game has changed for the best, and it's an awful lot of fun to watch.
Do you think that Byron has adjusted to that change as a coach, that he's catching up to, because it has changed so much?
I think more so this year. I think last year was more of an adjustment period, and we brought on, three more young players this year. So I think this year, he looked at the team, differently than it did a year ago, and I think his coaching style reflected it. He's much more open to everything, that's available to coaches, including, analytics. Byron would spend a lot of time with Clay Mosier, who in his first year was a bridge between our analytic department and our coaching staff. And every day, there would be data and charts and graphs and information passed on from, that department to our coaching staff. And I don't think Byron was as susceptible or, likely to listen to that his first year. So I think he's been very versatile this year and, open to changes and looking at things differently.
Let's take two more guys.
How do you think the young players has responded to his coaching style expectations?
Remains to be seen. Okay, Byron runs a tight ship. In terms of players taking advantage, of whatever it may be, getting late to the plane, getting late to practice, not being on the court on time, there was total and complete respect. Byron makes sure the players are where they need to be. They're ready to practice. Practices are organized. You better be rested if you're going to practice for the Lakers. You better be ready to work if you're going to practice for the Lakers. Was there a second part? I think, what was the second part of the question?
That was just one question. How you saw them handling the style and expectations.
Yeah, I think the second part of it is we have to wait a couple of years to see. You're not going to get results, in a month or three or four with players who are 19 and 20 and 21. You have to provide the structure, and it's going to take some time. And he's paving the way. I know he's hoping, that he coaches here forever. Okay, but a lot of times what we do is we're really preparing for the next GM or the next coach. And that's tough sometimes. I mentioned earlier, veteran coaches want veteran players. Because it does take time to develop young players. So we'll know in 2 or 3 years, how effective, you know, Byron was is apparent, you know, to the young guys on this team.
Can this team afford to wait 2 or 3 years for these young players to develop, especially potentially with another top 3 pick coming in?
We have to show progress. There's no doubt. Our fans have been incredibly understanding and patient. And to some degree this year, with Kobe's announcement, you know, got us through a very difficult year that could have been a lot more difficult. But it turned out to be a magical season in terms of celebrating a great player. But no, we cannot show great progress. We cannot not show great progress going forward.
Mitch, do you know yet where this top three compares to the previous years of the draft? I know you're still evaluating, but
yeah, I think I've seen all the top players. And if you get a top three pick, you know, I'll knock on the bottom of this table right here. Not only does it give you the ability to take a player that's considered one of the top three in the world, but you know, you also have the ability to move the pick. And I think there are some quality players that can be starters and all-stars in this league that go beyond two players.
Mitch, Darren and Serena, last two questions. Go ahead, Darren.
Mitch, it seems like the organization, when it came to marketing free agents in the past years, really emphasized L.A., the tradition of the Lakers. How important is it to really create a clear vision basketball-wise, and how big
Well, the last couple of years, you could only sell what you have. And the last couple of years, you know, our roster was pretty depleted. And on top of that, we were trying to sell an injured Kobe, you know, that might not play much going forward. So in the last 2 years, we would, you know, try to sell and advertise our best assets, you know, which continue to be playing for the franchise, the organization, the city of Los Angeles, our fan base, business opportunities, connections that you might make here that you might not make in another city, lifestyle. You know, a summer ago, really, with the exception of Kobe, that's all we had to sell, you know, and hope in the future. You know, as each season goes by, we get more and more to sell. You do try to find out what's important to the player, but it's tough to sell a team that doesn't have players on it to a free agent. So we do have more this summer. You know, granted they're young. We have a couple of veterans, but you know, maybe we could get multiple free agents versus a year ago we only can get one. Maybe that would be an impact. We don't know. But we do know that we're better off now than we were a year ago, and certainly better off than we were 2 years ago. And we'll sell whatever we have to sell to try to encourage players to come here.
Obviously, the last 3 years have been a struggle. But sitting here today, how quickly would you anticipate this franchise being back in contention for continuing for titles? Is it, you know, a couple years type of process? Is it a longer process than that?
Yeah, I can't predict that. You know, there's just too much that goes into, you know, getting a team in a position to contend for a championship. That'll always be our goal. What I think, you know, we need to do to be realistic is to show great progress and hope going forward. And the last 2 or 3 years, for several different reasons, it's been more difficult to do that. I think we're in a much better spot. Once again, from where I sit, I'm going to try to encourage the decision makers to be prudent with the money that we have, not just fill out a roster with players that'll give us no flexibility going forward, yet maybe we can win 40 or 42 games for the next 5 years. That's never been our goal in this city. And I know it's frustrating for fans, but it's my goal, and I know it's the organization's goal, to try to get the team and the organization in position to do much more than that. You know, whether that's the second round or the third round or being in the finals, you know, that takes a little bit of luck. You know, you got to stay healthy. You know, you got to have home court advantage. If you don't, you know, you need a break from an official on a call sometimes. It's really tough, you know, to predict, say, hey, you know, we're going to be in the finals next year. That's a tough thing to do.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.